In the classroom, we'll have the eye contact of the students. And also the class teaching helps a lot. Moreover, in the class, definitely, students will of age group, they will sit together and they will discuss of the age, same age group. Like we have seen that the Gurukula classes and olden days, as soon as king's sons grow up at the age of 10 years, they will send to the Gurukulas and they have to stay for the years together to enhance their knowledge. That type of may not be possible in the distance, but some extent, we have to improve a lot. That is, a communication technology is going to lead in coming days. There is no doubt in that. Digitalization of the software, so digitalization of the banking, this everything is a digitalization so that you can do cost cutting. It is absolutely correct. And to get the tune to the education, it may be require a little bit time. For example, like if you want to have the digital education, maybe after 3 years, if you would like to implement, yes, they start now, then try to implement. It's possible. But now, during this pandemic time, what to do it? Yes, we have to adapt at faster rate to this technology because it is possible because young people of percentage of nearly 33% of young people are in India. World 33% of young population is in India. When they could able to adapt a technologies like TikTok, WhatsApp, Facebook, why not a digital teaching, digital learning? Yes, it's possible. Definitely it will help a lot. And today's speaker will give the digital trends impact higher education by Professor Bhavani Prasad, Emeritus Professor of UGC, and how it is going to be. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming forward to share your valuable experience with today's participants and also the other students of the PG program. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Srinivas. It's nice introduction about your topic. In fact, you've covered half of my topic, rather.
Sorry, sir.
No, that is the beauty of having experience and experiencing the difficulties of.
Yes.
I'm really thankful to you for starting a very good intro. Let me thank Vageshwari because I know Dr. Sahab since a long time and I also know the group. So this is one in one group which is always trying to do something really good for the academic scenario. And I'm always with them, I mean, whether it is Devendra Reddy or Srinivas Reddy, Dr. Srinivas Reddy. And I'm also with you, Srinivas, right now. And I must always say that it is because of Hari Prasad I have taken up this assignment. Otherwise, I was not even thinking of this.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's because I have that affinity with you guys. So And interestingly, some of these participants whom you see, they were my PhD scholars. So I will be again interacting with them after a long gap, I would say.
Very great, sir. Very great.
And I'm also really happy that many other teachers also joining because first of all, let us come to a point, I mean, understanding that all of us are teachers, not by birth, but by choice, I would say.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
So because we are teachers, so obviously we always have this thing that goes on your mind.
And yes, sir.
We really see that people yes, who are interested with learning process to us, and how sir. Do we really, I mean, see that yes, they sir. Learn what they need to learn and they sir, also go sir. To the society. And contribute their skills for the development of the economy and society. This is the reason why teachers have a different role. I would say we have COVID warriors in terms of, police, doctors, health workers, etc. But I would say the educational warriors, the teachers, I would say, they also have a very important role in shaping the economy and building the economy. And that can never be ignored. If anybody is ignoring that part, I think we are at the detriment of the economy. So I'm really glad that I have been assigned this topic.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Hari Prasad Garu, sir, please introduce, sir, and please, sir will continue.
Oh, sir. Respected Speaker Sri Bhavani Prasad sir, and highly respected our principal, beloved principal Sri Srinivas Rao Garu, I am very happy to introduce my professor sir. Dear participant, good and cool evening to all. I really very happy with this meeting you, and thank you for joining this faculty development program. The main intention of this program is to discuss current basic issues and challenges of higher education, that is a post-COVID scenario. By focusing on these crucial issues, areas, critical areas, we expect the program will enable all participants to improve their skills for teaching and learning and writing a publishable research paper. On this day, that is a day one, our speaker, sir, is going to speak the digital trends impacting the higher education. We know this 21st century known as the digital era. Technology has been deeply impacting all domains of our life, including social, economic, cultural, even political also. Technology changed dramatically the way of interacting people and communicating with one another. Technology has given chance to access and communicate with others located in distinct parts of the world. Now, the tools what we are utilizing, that is the digital tools, are inciting drastic changes in all domains of life, what we may call, that is the digital age. The higher education institutions which have distinct roles in producing and disseminating knowledge have been experiencing such change pressures much more strongly. Just our beloved sir, speaker sir, said that the responsibility of the faculty in changing the economy is a great one. So therefore, the global competition for knowledge economy, fueled by the dominant roles of the digital connective tools, is forcing the higher education institutions to evaluate their current structures and take drastic decisions to improve these structures to better suit the needs and dreams of the present century. Digital advancements are forcing higher education institutions to transform and adopt suitable methods to meet the needs of the present 21st century. MOOCs, that is the massive online open courses, open educational resources, educational games, and the advancement digital platforms enabling increased interest. Keeping this in view, we, Department of Business Management, Vageshwari College of Engineering, Karimnagar, have undertaken to arrange a platform to know the current digital trends impacting higher education and how to mitigate the challenges. For this, we invited one of the renowned professor in the country, Professor G.B. Bhavani Prasad sir, UGC Emeritus, as a speaker for this FDP, day one FDP. I am very happy to introduce my professor, Sri Bhavani Prasad sir, who one of the renowned professor in the country in commerce and business management studies. He served above 35 years to University College of Commerce and Business Management, Kakatiya University, Warangal. Under his guidance, above 35 PhDs were awarded and many MPhils. He published a number of research papers in international and national journals. He acted as a chairperson and delivered keynote speeches many international conferences. I feel very, very proud to introduce my teacher, my guide, my guru, and my well-wisher, and my supporter. This FDP is arranged with his support only. With these few remarks, I would like to invite sir, before going to hand out the principal, sir, all participants, I request you, please mute your audio and video for better following. This program is intended to enhance the knowledge of faculties. So please turn off your audio and video. Please follow the speaker. If you want to interact, interaction is allowed before 15 minutes of the end of the session. Please use the chat box to raise your queries. And with a few words, sir, I invite our professor Bhavani sir, please take take over the session. Sir, over to Bhavani Prasad, sir.
Thank you, Hari. It's nice introduction you have given, and in fact, you have given more than what I really deserve, I would say. The issue is that all of us are going through the same scenario, that, you know, how to really adapt ourselves to the post-COVID situation when we are all teachers, and how to reach out to the students. In fact, some of you already started reaching out to students through Zoom classes, I would say. Of course, there are other alternatives also. We have alternatives like Google Meeting, and alternatives like GoToMeeting, alternatives like Namaste. Lots of video conferencing facilities. In fact, I would thank post-COVID for really making us to think differently. In fact, my life itself is a very interesting example. I started with a street corner school where we were made to use slate. And if we are not really studying well, we were really hit on our palms so that we learned things correctly. Then later on, we went on to the schools which have classrooms and classrooms with blackboards and chalk pieces. Then later on, we added projection systems, DLPs, that's what we use now. That is another system we started using. Later on, we started using computers with the help of PowerPoint presentations, especially Microsoft has done an excellent job in providing us the required software through which we can also develop PPTs and also interact with the students. The interesting thing I would like to say is all these things were done in a classroom environment and a classroom environment where we interact with the students face to face. It was really gratifying and interesting also because we can see the face of the student. The student is able to really absorb what we are saying. He or she is able to understand what is being taught and whether there is a known learning taking place or not. All these things are known instantaneously. In comes suddenly unknown variable called COVID-19, that is Corona. And all of us are made to stick onto the homes. And because all of us are made to stick onto the homes, the meeting point is disrupted now. Now, if the meeting point is disrupted, how do we overcome this? Because the teaching cannot stop, the learning cannot stop, and the students should not be stopped from gaining their skills, getting the knowledge, gaining the information. So this is where we go through the different kinds of challenges. So my lecture is divided into three parts. First of all, I'll also give a brief outline about what is the higher education scenario in the country. Then next, I'll also talk about what are the implications of COVID to our higher education. And thirdly, we talk about what are the strategies required for overcoming these implications. This is how I have split my PPTs. One thing is certain, I will stop at the drop of 7:15 so that I am more interested in getting queries rather than talking about what I want to talk about. The PPTs are there and I'll request Hari Prasad to share it to you. But what is more important is the interaction. Your contribution in FDP, any FDP, I strongly believe that it is a collective effort. All of us come with our thoughts. All of us come with our ideas. All of us come with our own opinions. And when you fusion this, and definitely it will come out with what is called a special mix of thoughts, ideas, and processes, which will really be enhancing the present teaching learning process. So I am counting on you guys, whoever is participating, that you have to come and be active and come out with your own ideas and processes. Okay. Let me start with what is happening in higher education scenario. Okay. See, interestingly, in spite of our being so backward, that's what people say, now we have developing and it is also developed. We are next to two countries in the globe, that is China, India, USA and China. USA had been the global master since a long time because they have been providing the higher education to most of the students from the different countries. Then China started dominating it because they have developed infrastructure. They have developed to teachers by training them in USA and starting their own. In fact, I remember when I was in Wuhan, luckily I was not there this period. It was around, I would say 2002, 2003. I went for a conference on digital technologies. And in fact, I would say that this infrastructure in Wuhan University, if you see, even our IITs cannot match it. That is the beauty of this thing. Now, because of that, we could never compete with China. Not only Wuhan, there are other universities also. We could not compete with China because we have very limited resource, I mean, infrastructure. Unfortunately, our previous governments were always looking at things as a disjointed platform, not a jointed platform. That is where China scored over India as well as United States. Then we go to the next slide. See, in all we have 52,627 colleges, whether they are government colleges or private colleges or standalone institutions, all those things put together. In fact, we have, as of 2020, this year I'm talking about latest data. If you look at, we have 1,000 universities approximately, more than 1,000, I would say. 50% central universities, 50 central universities, 402 state universities, 125 deemed universities, 334 private universities, and so on, so on. Interestingly, if you look at the partnership between private sector and public sector, since 1990, I would say that the private sector started to dominate the higher education system compared to the public sector, because public sector ability to cater is very limited compared to private sector because of the capital requirement, because of the people requirement, because of the infrastructure requirement. So that is what you find. So all these institutions have something, one thing in common, that they have infrastructure, they have the classrooms, they have the faculty, they have the systems which are either autonomous systems or affiliated system. For example, Bageshwar is affiliated to JNTU. That is an affiliated system. There are some colleges which are autonomous. They conduct their own, I mean, examination, their own classes, their own academic schedule, etc. So all these things together, they are trying to cater to huge number of students in India, whether they are B.Tech students or M.Tech students or B.A. B.Com, B.Sc. students or M.A. M.Com students, M.Sc. students or Ph.D. students, whatever it is. Ultimately, they pull into, but one thing which I wanted to focus upon is, how is that we have more almost similar to Chinese number of institutions, but still how is that China was able to progress ahead of India? If you see the next slide, you will see why. See, total enrollment, if you look at, we are not really far behind China. China has 29,100,600 students, while India has 26,650,953 students. It's not really too far off, we would say. But interestingly, if you look at the breakup, China had more students in vocational compared to India. More students enrolled into adult education. So they tried to make very interesting bridge in the sense, they wanted to go for skill enhancement. When students have developed skills, they will be useful immediately in the employment section, immediately in the product manufacturing system. But in India, unfortunately, we have more students and graduates, undergraduate, we have more students, postgraduate students, but we don't have people at the skill level. That's why we find shortage of people at the masonry level, shortage of people at the healthcare level, shortage of people in the, let us say, plumbing level, shortage of people in all different skill sets, which is the reason why we find, you know, most of the things are, there is not much progress in what is called manufacturing systems and service systems. Of course, at the same time, when you come to PhD, because that's also an interesting area, when it comes to PhD, again, China is dominating, and in fact, it is almost three times more than India. And most of these PhD enrollments are in science and technology. I would say that any country which is lagging behind science and technology research will always lag behind even other things also. In spite of our achievements in ISRO, our achievements in IITs, our achievements in IISc, etc., still we have less number of people in PhD being enrolled, which is again a pathetic scenario compared to. So in two areas, again, China is scoring well. One, vocational education, two, the PhD. So because of this, we find we are behind China and China is ahead of us. Okay, this is about a simple brief about higher education. Okay, now we'll go to what is happening we are also looking at people who are going to other countries for studying, okay, at the same time who are coming to India for studies. If you find in India, students prefer to go to United States, they prefer to go to Australia, next to Australia, next to UK, next Canada, next Arab Emirates. On the other hand, people who come from other countries, they are from Nepal, Afghanistan, Bhutan, Malaysia, Iraq. Interestingly, why is that this is happening? Why is that we are not able to tap other countries apart from these nearby countries, which are mostly SAARC countries or Southeast Asian countries? The countries like Iraq, etc. So this is about higher education. We'll go to implications. Suddenly, December, China says there is a new strain of virus has come into play, and we don't know how to cure it. There is no vaccine. There is no research available as to how to treat this. So now we are having the faster growth of virus. So nobody ever thought, nobody in the world thought that this virus is going to become global. This virus is going to become pandemic. And most of them, they thought, okay, it is only in China, let China take care of it. That is the first mistake most of the government done it. And within a period of 3 months, comes March, almost all the countries have started up getting affected by pandemic. That is, that made to take precaution by the governments. And you know, the only precaution right now available for COVID-19 is social distance. Social distance means we can never be together. We have to be away from each other. We have to maintain the distance, physical distance. And this is the major, limitation on higher education, because we have been trained, we have been accustomed to provide classroom education, not distance education. In fact, though universities have distance mode, in fact, they are in very limited role in the entire higher education as compared to what they are going to do. We'll come to that. See, almost all the governments have gone for lockdown, and the first thing they locked down is education institutions. Why? Because education institutions always, comprise of the youth between, let us say, 18 years to 25 years. And in fact, school-going children also is part of that. And this is the part of the population which is the foundation for any country. Unless this population is protected, and obviously your country can survive. That is why almost from 1.3 to 1.5 billion to students and youth across the world are affected. In fact, nobody ever thought that they will have to stay at home for so much period, and they are not even sure how much more time we have to stay at home. Then, once we close schools and colleges, it has its own social and economic costs. What are that? Especially most vulnerable marginal boys, especially in India, we had many people who used to go to the universities and colleges because of the government subsidization of the education, or because of the government providing accommodation in hostels, also mess charges, etc. Now all these things are suddenly disappeared. When this disappeared, those who have really come from villages, those who have come from, let us say, downtrodden communities, they are immediately cut from the basic major education system. And not only that, because of suddenly the learning is interrupted. Now, how do we overcome that? In fact, most of the colleges, they started providing classes through Zoom, and we found that the real attendance, I'm telling you again, once again, the real attendance for these Zoom classes was very, very less. Very, very less on two counts. One, people who have joined these classes, they were not really interacting with the faculty, hence they were not really feeling interested. Two, those who were in villages, those who were not having, smartphone, those who were not having network connection, they also could not, especially underprivileged learners, they could never get this advantage of going to a classroom. That is why this is a disruption, interrupted learning. So whatever they were learning, it is totally, interrupted. Then there is also the teachers. Interestingly, teachers also had to go through what is called a paradigm shift. Most of us are trained to teach in the classroom, look at the faces of the students, interact with them from person to person, and try to understand their learning deficiencies, then tailor our teaching on that basis. Now suddenly you say, no, you don't see the student, they don't see you face to face. It is only through digital medium you can interact with them. And what happens? How do you retailer your teaching system, teaching process? How do you retailer your pedagogy? All these things come into picture. So transition to distance learning platform becomes messy and frustrating. Now, challenges of creating, maintaining, and improving distance education. For example, universities already have some experience on distance mode of teaching, but what about the colleges like Vageswar Engineering, colleges like CBIT, colleges like, let us say, Nizam College, etc., etc.? How do they really create suddenly a distance mode of teaching where they were known for formal mode of teaching? In fact, the institutions which have got some ranking, good ranking, got their ranking only because they were strong in formal mode of teaching, not distance mode of teaching. And the students are also very good in these institutions like IITs, IIMs, etc., because they had very good inputs. They also had very good learning process through the formal systems. Now, moving learning from classrooms to homes really created enormous challenges, both human as well as technical. First of all, technical means we need to have application software like, you know, video conferencing software. Number two, we also need to have technical facilities like networking, especially. Most of the villages, they do not have proper internet. Number three, even though there is mobile network, most of them have not 4G. It may be 3G or 2G. So these kind of limitations always affect. Then challenges, and most important challenge most of the institutions are now facing, I think Vageswar also would agree with me that, how do we assess the students? Because earlier we used to have students coming into the colleges, writing examinations, taking examinations. So it was really good. In fact, you have a physical method of assessing the students with the written examination and written evaluation. Now, how do we do that? If you say, okay, you write your examination at your home and we evaluate here, there is always a possibility of postponing. There is always a possibility of skipping. Then also sometimes conducting exams on a distance basis also creates a question about what is the validity of these examinations. We don't know how the students are writing, whether they are writing with integrity or they are writing not with integrity, because this comes about fairness, especially access learning becomes variable. So this is another problem. So disruption to assessment, that is why the government of Telangana had to really pass all the 10th class students, because there was no way that the students can come into the exam centers and write. And if this is going to be repeated for higher education also, now what kind of output will be getting from the institutions? What kind of students will be coming out of this institution? How do we ensure that even if they come out of this mode, they have the requisite knowledge and requisite quality of knowledge? Then another implication, two implications you find is social isolation. In fact, in other countries, and recently we have also seen a lot of disturbance going in USA about a person and black being killed, and this spread into throughout. Why this has become so violent? I'm not saying this cannot spread. It can spread. It will spread. I know. But will they be so violent? Earlier also similar situations happened, but not so violent. This violence is linked not only about the incident, it is also about the lockdown effect. Because people were made to stay at homes and there was a lot of social isolation. Because there are no social interaction, people have become more violent. And that is why social unrest, increasing violence, and stress, depression, isolation, all these things started taking place because of this lockdown. Now, if this happens to our youngsters, especially young minds, the students, what will be the implication for the system, social system? Then parents unprepared for distance and home teaching. See, our parents, especially we are also parents, I would say, we prefer that our children should go to the schools, go to the colleges, and go through a formal learning mechanism, and we were never prepared for having children at home and trying to attend classes and whether the classes are really effective or not, whether these guys are learning or not, whether they are really attending the classes or really something else. So these kinds of things, you know, this absence of formal system resulted in sometimes family disturbances and disturbance in family relations. Now, the other implications, if you see, there is a need for digital access to all, which is again a big question mark. Even a country like USA also, they find it is very difficult because for them, higher education is very, very restricted compared to India. India, we have mass higher education. In USA, it is a restricted higher education. Similar thing in China also. They don't think higher education is essential for people to survive. Then challenges in digital empowerment through digital inclusion. See, people have mobile phones. We talk of mobile revolution, fine. But what this mobile revolution has a limitation in the sense, when it goes to interiors, it doesn't work. And interiors are not networked. And interiors do not have enough computing power so that they can interact with computers. So these are all the problems we have to look into for providing higher education. In fact, there was one suggestion by some of the teachers. I think you also will appreciate that. They said, if the students have gone back to villages, we still go on online teaching, but these villages should have a hub where there'll be a group of computers available for them to sit, to listen, to interact, etc. But how many villages have this facility? Nope. Even if they are computers, they might be one or two, and they are used by the office of the village panchayat. Then there is also a requirement of digital entrepreneurship and industry for higher education. In the sense, so far the software available is mostly, for example, video conferencing, but the remaining is only left to the teachers. Now, do we have digital educational software like Baiju? That is, Baiju is also up to plus two level. Now, what about the graduation, undergraduate level? What about the postgraduate level? What about the doctoral level where people want to see to develop? So we don't have software required for higher education. Then another important thing is cyberspace at the global level. And we know as the digital footprint goes on widening, the danger of cyber crimes also goes on widening. And in fact, in some of the cases, it is much more dangerous. Then another thing is reaching out to digital access. How do we reach out to people who do not have digital access? This is another question we come across. Then all these things require a lot of money, and we need to invest. The government needs to invest multi-billion dollars because these are all the implications. Just one small virus could disrupt the entire structure of higher education. No one ever thought, and that is what is happening now. These are all the implications. At the same time, the implications also resulted in opportunities. Opportunity number one, in India, especially for India, the lockdown has come as a blessing in disguise, especially the fear of poor quality of online teaching and teachers' hesitation to use online portals. Now it has disappeared. Now every teacher, as of now, who is in service, they know how to use online portals. They also know how to go for online assessment. They also know how to use online quizzes to assess the quality of the students. So this is really a real challenge met by the ingenuity of our teachers. Wherever they are, my hats off to them. My all appreciation go to them to adapt. Who are able to adapt? That is the beauty of Indians. Indians are known to adapt to any kind of challenge pretty fast. And likewise, students, digitally proficient students, are going for online learning with great excitement. In fact, they are understanding that this digital learning has no limitation. Classroom learning has a limitation. But digital learning has no limitation because there are so many sources through which you can learn. Then the universities in India also, in other countries now, need to focus on the effective integration of classroom and laboratory-based teaching. This is another big question, especially the colleges like engineering colleges, the colleges like medical colleges and the colleges which are providing technical education, imparting technical education, the colleges who are involved in that is as science, basic science and technology research, how do they integrate the online classroom with laboratory-based teaching? Can we really do online laboratory? How far it is going to be effective? So there's all the things which come to now, workshops, seminars, brainstorming, and all. Interestingly, I think all of you must have been exposed that almost there is a race for conducting webinars, not seminars, webinars. There is a race for conducting what is called FDPs. There is a race for conducting dissemination of knowledge through online, due to video conferencing. So in earlier, we never used to have so much of race, so much of exposure. Now all of you are exposed to multiple programs. In there, I think I talked to one of the teachers, college teacher. He said, sir, right from morning till evening, I am into one faculty development program or another, or one webinar or another. Really, it is opening my eyes. Interesting. And this is what is happening. This is an opportunity which we are able to utilize, and we will still have to utilize in the future also. So it becomes more professionally oriented teaching, learning, and one more thing we have to understand is, earlier we are limited to the faculty available at the colleges only. Now that limitation is gone. Any student can interact with any faculty once the webinar is open, and other these webinars are without cost, and that is really beauty of the system. It's an opportunity. Then, earlier, Indian universities students always used to think of going to other countries because, especially MS in US is always the most sought after program. Now, because of the travel restrictions and safety concerns, people cannot go. Now it is time for Indian universities to try to win some students away from international destinations. How can they do that? University dues can do considering launching programs that can combine education from other countries with our education system. That is what we say, what is called dual degree programs. The program which is jointly hosted by Indian University and American University or Australian University or Canadian University or any other university for that matter. So what is happening? Our students need not go to Australia. Our students need not go to US. Our students need not go to Canada. In fact, what I have, one of my friend's son got admission in Canada, he could not go. So they said, till COVID is replaced, you will be offered one semester online in India. And if you need, we have a partner university available. You can also interact with them. And your evaluation is done by this university. And this is transferred, these credits are transferred to our university the moment the lockdown and travel restrictions are lifted. It is a choice. And immediately they came for my advice, told them, don't hesitate. Take online, complete this period so that the time is not lost. Then when it is over, then you can go for open. And in fact, the student is able to save a lot of money in terms of travel, in terms of stay, in terms of living expenses in other countries. And this is what excellent opportunity for Indian universities, right? And the hybrid online and on-campus learning is always active. Then special courses focused on high demand areas as artificial intelligence, machine learning, medical, etc., all these computer programs. We really do not have to go to labs. In fact, that is why I was wondering when NAC and AICT was insisting on computer labs. Because computer labs are not required. Computer servers are required for the institutions. The servers which can cater to multiple nodes. Like we have hub and spoke system. You know, the college can be a hub and the students can use hub or spoke system by connecting their laptops. And they can go on learning almost all types of computer programming and et cetera through interactive learning process, which is now available in most of the cases. That's what I'm telling you. So we can also follow what is called hub and spoke model. One university in India can cater to 2-3 universities in other countries. So what is happening? The other countries can utilize the facilities in India and they say, we are collaborating with you. We have what is called this. Our university will become a satellite campus their university will become main campus, and the students' physical socialization need not be constrained because of this online education system. Given the importance of international work experience, in fact, Indian universities can attract domestic students by providing a global experience, especially in the software industry, because most of our Indians are crazed about software industry. They can always provide what is called online work experience to all these students who are interested in learning. The lockdown has accelerated adoption of digital technology. In fact, we know at present, companies like TCS, companies like Cognizant, companies like Accenture, etc., they instruct their people, at least 75% of them can work from home. And this is because few things we have to understand. One, there was a mobile revolution of moving from 3G to 4G technology. Then there is also mobile network revolution of fiber optics broadband. There is also networking expanding into multiple high speed bandwidth. So all these things have helped business houses, institutions, analytics, computer data methods, online education solutions have been forced to work in tandem. So this is an ideal time to experiment and deploy new tools. In fact, I would even not be surprised if the design of a rocket, the design of a satellite could be done online, and the students can be made part of party to that. And at the last leg of the design, the production goes into actual physical facilities. It is also a fact that when we use technology in education, we come up with different things, different approaches, this thing. So it gives what is called the entire shift from teacher-centric education to student-centric education. In fact, the student can now ask, sir, this is what I need, this is what I don't need. And the teacher has to tailor the courses, tailor the dissemination of knowledge according to. So this makes it more valuable to the students and more, skill development orientation. Then we also talk about virtual classrooms. In fact, virtual classrooms and online tools have become very important, especially post-COVID scenario, because virtual classrooms means people can be anywhere, but when they join to a hub, they become part of a classroom, but it's not really a physical classroom, it is an online classroom. And this is where teachers will be able to interact to. In fact, I would say the physical infrastructure restricts the number of students. In fact, the present scenario is that all the colleges are supposed to have half of the students in the class, physical classroom, than what they used to have. But in the online classroom, the restriction is gone. If you have 60 strength, you can go to 180 strength in one go. When you can do it that way, you can reach more people, you can reach more students, and you can also see that more skill development is done. Apart from that, teachers, parent meeting, staff, student meeting, all of them are doing online. And because of it, there's a lot of cost saving also taking place. Now, pedagogy in digital education is important link, especially course content, the teachers, the technology, and the course takers. Now, I request the teachers who are listening to this, now please make your course content as creative as possible. Number one. Number two, as relevant as possible. Number three, as impact oriented as possible. And this can be done with the help of the available tools, available technology, available systems we have. And that is why democratization technology is now an important issue. That is like internet connectivity, telecom structure. And interestingly, right now, all of us are going through this. We are going through democratization technology. All of us are in different places, from different places, but still we are able to interact. We are able to interact only because we are exposed to technology and technology is available to us to meet each other. And in fact, technology-based education is more transparent, does not make a difference between front bench and back bench and girls or boys. Don't you think it is really very interesting? Then now we go for the strategies. If you have opportunities, how do you go for them? One immediate measures or continuity. So how do you do open source digital learning system? Solutions and learning management software should be adopted. In fact, I appreciate the present government for their digital initiative. In fact, last year we had a seminar on Digital India conducted by Kids College Warangal. Fortunately, I was also a part of the keynote address. We could see that even before COVID, the government of India was thinking how to really spread digitalization, how to make all our people digital learned, digitally educated. So that is where they have started what is called Diksha platform, which is meant for disseminating knowledge to students from different nook and corner of the country. This is the first strategy the higher education system has to follow. The second is learning solutions. It is found that there is increase in mobile internet users in India. Most of the smartphones are mobile internet, and fortunately, because of Jio or Airtel or even other mobile providers providing high speed 4G data. And not only that, because they're also providing data at a very low cost compared to other countries, it is expected that 85% of households by 2024 will be having access to networks. And once they have access to networks, the scope for digital learning is enormous, and there is no limit and there is no end to that. Then third strategy, this is especially for us, you can say. We need to design our courses based on the evolving demand in the globe. Earlier, India was designing courses only for India, and all the students were going out. They were going because the Indian education system was not offering something that they could have learned and they could have become employable. Now, Indian education system needs to develop a demand-oriented supply trends, understand, then create courses related to global mobility of students and faculty, improving the demand for higher studies in India. In fact, we don't know, Indian Institute of Science is having what is called reverse migration of students. That is, students going to other countries, they are coming back here. Likewise, IITs also are encouraging reverse migration. Likewise, IIMs are also encouraging reverse migration. Now, the important thing issue here is, how can we make even other institutions also so good, so effective, so strong, so technically competent? And that is where we need to have what is called institutions gearing up for what is called higher digital scenario, especially demand and supply trends across the globe. So we should go across not just these 4 or 5 countries from which we are getting students. We should also get students even from other countries. There are lots of countries where students are moving to USA. Now USA is losing it because of this restriction. India can take advantage of that. Then it is also important that the current delivery of methods, teaching methods. And the present teaching method is always what is called rudimentary. We say it is like this. I tell you, listen. What is this? I tell you, listen. And ultimately, they have to listen what they need to listen, not what we tell. And this is one area I think there's a lot of need for innovations in delivery of courses and pedagogic methods. So that is the reason why we need to have what is called EdTech reforms. EdTech reforms have to fusion different innovative ideas into one big package to be delivered to the students. In fact, especially I would say that Indians, we should start with our schools. Young minds are open minds. They adopt pretty fast. In fact, you see, you take an Indian and keep it in China for Indian student like 5 to 6 years boy or girl and keep them for 2 years in China. They speak very fluent Chinese compared to us. It becomes very Herculean task for us to learn Chinese. The same student, if you keep them in, let us say, Mexico, they within 1 year, 2 years, they learn Spanish without any issue. So what is happening here? Catch them in and provide them for all the inputs. Once they are trained into all these different language skills, different technical skills, and they'll be the best manpower for the entire globe. In fact, India is what supposed to be the human resource supplier. In fact, if you go through the Complete Advantage of Nations written by Michael Porter, Michael Porter clearly said that India will become a hub for supplier of manpower to world, because world is now becoming old, India is still young. Then Indian government has already started what is called Swayam. I think some of you must have taken these training programs. Likewise, MOOCs, just now our principal also mentioned. Then EPG Patashala, or e-content containing modules on different streams. Then CEC UGC YouTube channel, which is known as Vidwan. Then you also have what is called NEAT. AICT also is doing its bit with the help of private and public partnership model. Then you have educational technology companies like NDL, National Digital Library. In fact, you know, I would say that because of this digitalization, the hardbound copies has no relevance in the system. And this physical space, which is reserved for libraries, will also have no space in the system. In fact, everything will be online. The books, the reference material, the journals, the technical manuals, everything could be online. And that is why, that is what the company is trying to do, NDL. Then we also have what is called a new type of thing, as I told you, know, spoken tutorial, free and open source software for education. And eYantra, Google Classroom, etc. These are all the things which are going to bring out a lot of change, and we need to adopt them pretty fast if our institution has to become one of the best in the country. Then the government, as again, I appreciate the government, both the government of India and state governments. They started, especially Telangana government is doing a lot of work on these things. NKN, National Knowledge Network. When you go to an institution, you learn the knowledge from that institution only. Then you have to go to another institution for learning the knowledge. But when you are exposed to the digital platform, all these different institutions contribute their different streams of knowledge. You can imagine how enormous it would be, how beautiful it would be for the students to learn multi-dimensional skill set, multi-dimensional knowledge set. Then national project and technology enhanced learning system. This is again the government initiative, NPTEL. Then national mission on education through information communication technology is another initiative. National Academy Depository, this is another initiative. These are all things which are taking place even before COVID. Interestingly, now the only thing that is required is now the government needs to give more push. The more is the push given, the better it is exposure. The better is the exposure, the more will be the students be exposed to this kind of things, and more will be the faculty trained in multitasking scenario, multi-knowledge-based scenario. And all of us will be doing our bit to see that things will happen. Then, this is a big question I asked in the beginning itself, the challenges, implications. How do we assess our students? Now I start with a simple question. Do we need to assess our students? Because all the students who are going out of colleges, if they need to get admission to higher education, they have to go through what is called an online common entrance test, whether it is JEE, whether it is NEET, whether it is, let us say, CAT, whether it is GATE, or whatever it is, GRE. All of these things are done by independent online assessment agents. When these assessment agencies prove that these are the students which are eligible for getting into things, and especially when they talk about skilling assessment, then obviously, why do we have another set of examinations here? Who is going to look at these values? But still, to give credibility to the degrees, provided by the universities, to give credibility to the degrees provided by the autonomous institutions, to give degrees provided by the colleges, then we need to have assessment system. But these assessment system need not be internal to the institution. They can be an external online assessment agency. This itself is an opportunity and also a strategy. So basic education systems like delivery platforms, IT infrastructure, and PC, desktop, mobile, etc. have been planned and for improvement. This is what the government is doing now. In fact, government has a proposal in the long run that every student should be given either with a laptop or a tab through which tablet through which they can be accessed to these online digital platforms. Then going forward, use of technology reaching, teaching and recruitment will lead to new era. Now, today we have the very old rudimentary system of recruitment of faculty. Again, I would say this is, I also was one of the beneficiary of that system where I had gone to the interview and the faculty, the experts came to the selection committee. They have assessed whatever the knowledge base I had and they have selected. That is good. But still, that is only at the point of movement. But what is required is over a period of time, we conduct a series of tests and so that we can also see that whether the faculty, not only the core knowledge, but also the technical knowledge, the adaptability to the digital technologies is there. These kinds of things have to be become an important parameter in selection of the faculty. Then physical infrastructure. In fact, I would say that especially the colleges like medical colleges, engineering colleges, they have spent a lot on creating physical infrastructure because AICTE was insisting. They say 1:1 computer. Suppose you have 180 students, you should have 180 computers. Agree. That is because the labs are the only source of dissemination of practical knowledge for the students when they come to the college and they don't have access to the network, they didn't have access to the laptops. Now when you have the students, when the students can afford the tabs, laptops, etc., where is the need for such a huge expenditure on infrastructure? But the infrastructure which we create should be more on licensed software. The infrastructure which we create will be more on the high power servers. The infrastructure we could use, is developing excellent network with high level of bandwidth so that no student is ever denied of access to the content. Because if there is bandwidth limitations, if there is network server limitations, then there is always a problem of what is called circle going around and the student loses interest in digital education. So they need to go for what is called liberal education. In fact, now the government is also thinking, especially MHRD, that one can pursue one regular degree along with one online degree. Because regular degree, you need to go to the institution and you have to follow all the rules and regulations provided by the institution or university, and they have to go through the process. But in online education, there is nothing like that. They can enroll to any university or any course anytime, and they finish that course, then enroll to another course. And this is how the system, which is an American system, also doesn't talk about a formal fixed syllabus. They say you are given certain courses option, and if you complete these courses, you go to next semester. Once you complete certain number of courses, you go to. So, but the number of courses choice is the choice of the student. We can also do that in India once we go for the digital platform so that the constraints of faculty, the constraints of laboratories, the constraints of classroom environment will be removed through online education. So that is why, again, it will result in a balance of economics of good education. Now let me conclude. I am coming to a conclusion because I need to give some time for you to talk also. So we are really scared of COVID. There is no denying that, I would say. We are also really worried about what will happen because of the increasing rate of infections going up and increasing rate of death rate happening. But that is the only way we can we can overcome that is now we have to look into different dimensions. So we have to face unforeseen challenges and implications and opportunities. And not only that, please don't be under the impression that Corona will go within 6 months or 1 year. It is going to be with us till we are there. And that is this the major assignment for Corona is to be with us. It is like a family member, you can say. So we cannot avoid it. The only thing is we have to look up, develop new opportunities. So we need to have drastic change in the mindset of the policymakers, authorities, and students. And the faculty selection also should gradually link to technology friendliness. Student admission process also to based on this. And the limitations of number of degrees. This is my advice. The limitations of number of degrees should be removed. If a student is really interested and willing to put in a lot of hard work, willing to go through the rigor of going through different course requirements of online courses, why should we restrict the student? Why not we encourage them? Why not we make them become diamonds of education system? Why should we make them only, let us say, a simple jewelry of education system? No. That is the reason why there is not limitation on number of degrees. And there is also evaluation process which need innovation approach. What kind of approach we need to follow? Again, we have to look into, for example, earlier we are known for descriptive answering system. Now, descriptive answering is useful only for certain things. You can create interactive examination system based on what? Based on quiz, based on logical reasoning, based on what is called thematic apperception test, based on, there are lots of options available. Once we create that, we also adapt that to the course which you are delivering. Obviously, the student will be much sharp and he will be much polished. And he'll be coming out with, I don't say flying color, he will be coming out, he or she will be coming out with shining colors. That's what we need. Then accreditation parameters, evaluation criteria also has to change. Unfortunately, I don't know what NAC is going to do, AICT is going to do, or even UGC is going to, but they need to really think totally differently. And the institutions which are really good at offering online education system, right from admission to the declaration of degree, they should be encouraged. And they should be encouraged that there should be what is called an independent evaluation system of the students coming out of these institutions, so that the rating of the institutions is based on the results obtained in the independent evaluation, not based on certain criteria like how many faculty are there, what is their publication. They are there. Apart from that, this also is there. So we need to, in a nutshell, I have a feeling that we need to go for a paradigm shift in the higher education. So thank you for patient listening. Be safe and stay safe. Take a pledge to become educational warriors for spreading knowledge and wisdom to our ever promising youth. Let us fight COVID-19 together and show the world that we do not take the fight going down. And this is India and we are Indians. And I conclude my talk here. Now I leave the forum open for questions. Hari?
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Very interesting points you covered. Institutions worldwide, students enrollment in various subjects worldwide, and how COVID-19 impacting the student population, implications of COVID-19 on higher education institutions, and the requirement of digital entrepreneurship that you raise at the point. And another opportunities for higher educations post COVID-19, and also strategies. What are the strategies to government and higher educations to implement for overcoming the digital challenges? These are the points you well covered, sir. Thank you very much for your excellent session.
These are just some ideas I wanted to keep together, and I want more ideas from our participants.
Thank you, sir. The participants, we are our professors, sir, speakers, sir, is very, very interesting to interact with you. That is the reason why he left the more time. Actually, we intended to allow 15 minutes before, but he has taken the half an hour time to interact with you. Please raise your hand Then our coordinator, system coordinator will unmute you. Please raise your hand or use the chat box to raise your question. Please raise hand. Okay. May post your question. Yes, yes. Your question. Please post your question in chat box or raise the hand. Then it is our coordinator will unmute you. All the faculties, participant, please participate in interaction session. Anyone in? Yeah, from Subhartra has raised the hand. As a teaching community, we have now adopted to online teaching, but through online teaching methods, how can we help our students develop employability skills? How do we help students to develop interpersonal and job skills through online teaching methods? Sir? This is a question raised by Subhartra.
Okay, what's his name you said?
Subhartra, madam. Subhartra.
Subhartra, madam, nice and important question you raised here, because ultimately the proof of the pudding is eating. No, so if we deliver a lecture which is not going to be useful to employment, there is no meaning for the lecture, there is no meaning for the lesson, there is no meaning for the course. Now the first question I would ask is, are we confident that the courses which we are offering develop employability skills? This is something which we need to answer ourselves, first of all. Number two, assuming that if they have employability skills, how do we impart them to the students who is not in front of us? This is the second challenge that we are facing now. The third challenge is, are we really interacting with the industry so that the skills required for the industry is being built into our coursework? So these are all really basic issues I'm talking about, nothing to do with digital education or online education, etc. This has nothing to do with that. But this is about the basic structure of the course design itself. So that is one. The second thing is, when you are talking about soft skills, that's what we say, interpersonal skills, etc. You know, there are really some beautiful videos available on YouTube. And there are people who were trained to become very strong, very vocal by going through those videos. So we have to develop such kind of inputs. We have to develop such kind of what is called exercises, interactive exercises, so that the student will start learning from one stage to another stage to another stage, so that the student becomes compatible to the environment to which he or she is going to go. Not only that, they will also have what is called the necessary communicative abilities to face the interviews. They will also have necessary knowledge base, the skill base. So the skill base has to be built into this course. This is something which the teacher has kind of done to do. But people say, you know, in our system, the universities are designing the courses. When the university designs the course, you have to just impart the course. This is the problem. But why the universities are not developing a course which is skill-based, that is something, again, we need to look into. I hope you understand, Subhadra Garu. Next.
Anyone? Please.
Because I need please another 10 minutes for one more part. That's why, yeah. I just wanted to listen to questions, then get back.
So another question, sir. Yakaya, sir.
Yakaya?
Yakaya, sir. Hmm. How to release disability students, COVID guidance, UGC? How to release, sir? Sridhar Reddy, sir, you please unmute to Yakaya, sir. How to release disability students, COVID guidance? What is the, this question is, come have, is that? Please unmute the Yakaya, sir.
No, not this, sir. I think you gave me the question, so I'll answer that. Mm. I'll answer that. Very simple. So what is the limitation of a disabled person? Mobility. Yakaya, I think you are listening to me now, right?
Sir.
How are you? Fine.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Fine, sir. సార్ డిజేబుల్ స్టూడెంట్స్ కు యూజీసీ గైడ్ లైన్స్ మాకు ఏ విధంగా ఉపయోగపడుతుంది దాని గురించి అడిగాను సార్ కోవిడ్ 19 మీద డిజేబుల్ స్టూడెంట్ పాస్
ఆర్టిఫికేషన్స్ యూజీసీ హస్ నాట్ డెవలప్ ఎనీ స్పెషల్ కోవిడ్ గైడ్ లైన్స్ యాజ్ ఆఫ్ నౌ ఐ థింక్ ప్రాబబ్లీ పోక్రియల్ ఇస్ వర్కింగ్ ఆన్ దట్ ప్రాబబ్లీ అనదర్ 1 మంత్ డౌన్ ద లైన్ విల్ బి గెట్టింగ్ ఇట్ యాజ్ ఆఫ్ నౌ దేర్ ఆర్ నో స్పెషల్ కోవిడ్ 19 గైడ్ లైన్స్ ఫర్ హైయర్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ ద ఓన్లీ గైడ్ లైన్ దట్ ఇస్ వి ఆర్ We have to follow what is called social distancing. We have to follow what is called physical distancing. And we have to deliver the lectures only through digital medium. That's it. And especially for physically challenged people, what is their limitation? The limitation mostly is mobility, right? If the mobility is the issue, digital platform is the best platform for them to really deliver the effective classes, excellent classes they can develop and impart to the students from being where they are. They don't need to go anywhere. For us, we have to go to classroom, use the boards, etc. But if you have the technology with you, if you have the inclination, if you have the necessary knowledge set, if you have necessary skill set, you integrate all these things together, try to provide the inputs right from the place where you are. All that you need is only one laptop and a network. And a subscription to video conferencing. That is how we are trying to do now. Even though we are not physically challenged, we are also doing the same thing, right? So COVID-19 guidelines are not yet out. If they are out, I think probably, definitely, I think that they will also consider the limitations of the physically challenged persons. And I think they will also provide special provision for that.
Sir,
I hope I answered you, Ayakaya.
Sir, Prabhakar sir asking you one question, sir.
Yes, sure.
Yes. What his question is that universities are already more number of universities are suffering with lack of faculty members. More number of universities are suffering with lack of faculty members.
Yes.
Whether UGC will recruit faculty members through digital modes or will continue with the same faculty?
Firstly, we have to understand it is not the UGC which is recruiting the faculty. It is either the state government or the central government. This is something which we have to be very clear about it. UGC provides only the guidelines for eligibility of being selected as a faculty. So if you go through the UGC, UGC guidelines include net qualification or set qualification, or the number of articles published in the UGC care list, etc., etc., they give. That's all. UGC never gets into recruitment process. Unfortunately, this is where the problem is. If UGC were to really recruit, in fact, I would also prefer, my opinion is that the government of India should have what is called a national pool of teachers, not state level. National pool of teachers should be recruited, and they have to assign these teachers to different institutions. Then all these limitations would have gone just like that. And unfortunately, UGC has preferred to be only a funding agency. They did not bother. They are not looking into other things because of their own act constraints. So it is the state government and central government which has to take up this issue. But are the state governments willing to do that? Are the central government willing to do that? This is a question again the governments will have to answer, which I cannot answer, not even UGC answer. But in the given scenario, as of now, even if the governments want to recruit, because of the lockdown, they cannot. So the universities will have to go along with whatever the strength of faculty available, and they have to supplement the strength of faculty, the available faculty, with additional resources, additional academic resources through online digital platforms. That's it. That's what I'm telling you. Earlier, for three sections, you need to have three sets of faculty. Now, if you are following digital platform, there is a possibility. I'm not saying it is going to happen. There is a possibility that one set of faculty is enough for taking care of all three sets of three sections. Because ultimately one laptop, one network, and it can connect to, I think Zoom is allowing you 200 connections.
200, right? 1,000, up to 1,000 people, sir.
No, it's okay. So if you can connect up to 1,000 people, why do you need so many faculty sets?
Yes, sir.
That this is a real challenge, real danger the faculty is facing. But at the same time, there is something which one has to understand. Each faculty comes with his or her own caliber, quality, ingenuity, creativity, and dedication. So that nobody can replace. Even digital platforms cannot replace this kind of thing. So obviously, we need to have more people so that more inputs can be given to the faculty.
Sir, another question by Rani Madam, sir.
Okay.
Rani Madam is asking another question. What kind of evaluation process would you suggest for online mode of education? What is the evaluation?
You're already going through, Madam. Rani Madam, I think is she working somewhere in Vageshwari?
No. She is working from Hyderabad, sir.
Okay. We are already going through the evolutionary process. Is it not evolutionary process? Normally for FDP, if Vageshwari is conducting, I would have hired a car, come to Karimnagar, and you would have come to Karimnagar. All of us would have met in Karimnagar. And probably for the 5 days, you will be cursing yourself. Why is that I have to come to all the way to Karimnagar, leaving my family, my home, etc., etc. Now, is it not evolutionary process? So, very simple. What we have been doing, the classroom environment, now we have to do it in a digital environment. But the difference is, in a digital environment, you need to adapt yourself, you need to adapt your coursework so that the simple lecturing type doesn't work. You need to go for innovative method of teaching, and this will happen over a period of time. I think, Rani Madam, you must have already taken some online classes to your students. Because it is happening in the middle of the academic year, we cannot do anything in the semester. So we continue with the old thing. Great. But beyond that, if you move into next semester, please see that your topics, your coursework, your delivery of topics, skill set should be different. And that is how you will be able to evolve into a digital teacher. And in fact, I wanted to tell you one more thing here. I think technology guys, especially the principal, would be able to support me here. That now we are going into more into artificial intelligence scenario. So what is artificial intelligence scenario? The machine will learn how to respond to different kinds of situations. Suppose we create an artificial intelligence teacher, like chatbot. You can say teachbot. And once the chatbots are created, then evolution will be that the chatbots will supplement your teaching effort, your creative ability, and the chatbots' programmed deliverability will have to be merged together. This is going to happen in future, though it's not going to be very far, because I still remember I started with the computer which is called PC, which had only 32 kilobytes memory. We had to load multiple disks. From there, now we are talking about tabs which can have 1 TB capacity, secondary memory, and 8 GB RAM is minimum these days. It may go to 16 GB, it may even go to 32 GB, RAM itself I'm talking. Now we are also moving from, let us say, HDD to SSDs, which again, they substitute, they reduce the whole shape of the computer chain. So what is that? All these technology initiatives, as a teacher, we have to follow through. Only when we follow through, I think we'll be able to adapt and evolve into a digital teacher. Now, it is no more a question of being a teacher. Now you have to become a digitalized teacher, probably.
Sir,
I think I'll take one more question. I have one video to play.
Sir.
One more question I'll take, that's all.
Okay. Spurti Madam is going to know from you, sir, how to identify slow learners in virtual classes. What are the strategies to be implemented to improve how learners in online teaching mode? How to identify the slow learners? That is the question. What is the strategy for implementing them?
A very interesting question, because in a classroom, whether the student likes or not, they are made to sit. And probably they sit because that's how it is. But in a digitalized environment, there is no physical contact between the teacher and the student. And hence, there is no binding on the students to be with you, unless this attendance is linked to the marks, the attendance is linked to the grades, the attendance linked to the evaluation system. And some of the colleges are doing it already. Fine. How do you make it interesting? My question is very simple. How much of lecture method, how much of interactive method you are following? In a classroom environment, we go for, let us say, 70% of lecture method and 30% of interactive method. And that is how the classroom pedagogy takes place. But in a, what is a digital platform, the interactive sessions will be 70% and your lecture should be 30%. That is the only way you can make the students stick on them. And the interactive section should be inclusive of evaluative process. You give an input, you give a concept, test it immediately. You give a concept, test it immediately. You give a concept, test it immediately. So you are putting a goal for each learning process in the interactive session. And only when they go through that, then you go into that other goal. Only when they accomplish that goal, then they go into another goal. This is how we have to do it. So ultimately, what is happening here? Interactive, evaluative system together will make it compulsory for the students to be part of the online classes. And not only that, they will also know the progression. They will also know the environment, the progression of their learning process. And accordingly, we can also do it. So, any further questions?
Only
I'll stop
one
here. No, I'll no, stop no, no. here.
No, sir. One madam is waiting for you.
Ayo.
Samatha madam. Samatha madam. Dr. G. Samatha madam. Please ask the question.
Good Samatha, evening, sir. How are you, sir?
I am fine. I'm all of you. You can see me now on screen.
Sir, actually, we are very lucky and fortunate enough to listen your class, sir, after a long time. Yes, and you have given exactly the blueprint of present situation, sir, along with the international statistics, sir. And you have grasped the 5 levels of teaching methods from your starting career to till now.
So,
and we are very lucky to listen you, sir, because you have crossed all the levels.
No, I consider myself fortunate to have really gone through different evaluation processes. This is what Puti was asking. How do we evaluate? Right. Some Rani also asking, I think.
Yes,
because
sir. That's what.
Teachers can never stop from learning. Students can stop from learning, but teachers can never stop from learning. This is the beauty, and this is also the challenge. And the people who consider this as a beauty will be always beautiful. And people who will consider this challenge, they always become winners. And people who think this is boredom, they have to decide what they want to become. That's it. Really glad that I'm interacting with a very elite participant, because we have to work together, Samatha. This is not one person's job. All of us will have to come out with something. In fact, the students, though they may be interested, they are not interested. Why they are not interested? They are not interested because we are not making it enough interesting to them on two counts. One, the delivery. Two, the benefit.
Yes, sir.
Most of the students are under the impression that this education system is not going to be beneficial to them. And that is why we find people with MBA joining constable jobs, people with MTech going for attender applications. How pathetic this is, you can tell me. And you don't find this scenario in any other country.
Yes, sir.
Only in India. I really feel sorry for that, because these guys who could have really done some wonderful things for the country, and they are made to do things which they are not supposed to do. Why this is happening? This is not happening because the system is not giving them the benefit. When a student is not expecting any benefit out of a system, why do you expect him to be committed to the system? Even in their place, if we are there, we also will be the same situation, right?
Yes, sir.
So let us hope something will change. At least I request all of you to look into these things, come out with some papers, think about how better we can do with this opportunity. And I request COVID also to make us to think differently.
Thank you, sir. Thank
yes,
you.
Sir.
Thanks, sir. What do you say?
Thank
that?
You, sir.
What do you say that, sir? That is correct. A teacher has to learn always to make the student learn. Sir.
No, I'm just playing a video. I hope this video comes to you if it is a sharing thing. 1 minute.
It's an awful time in the world, but I think it's a really interesting time in education. We've never
How do I
had
share it?
A moment like this one where everyone at the same
Okay, now I'm going to share this video. Just you see, it is not only our problem. It is a problem for everyone. So this is professor from Chicago. He tells what are the problems they are facing and how they want to really answer this. Just see this video. I think we can say Janaganamana. There is a problem with the network at my
time has jumped into this technology.
The coronavirus is changing life as we know it on a daily basis. COVID 2025 will explore how the pandemic is rewriting our future.
The ability to teach through the technology is really powerful. I can lecture, I can call on students, I can engage in Socratic dialogue. I can replicate what I can do in the classroom. Things that have been hard in the past, bringing in guest speakers, being in multiple campuses at once, the ability to tie those together in a much more seamless fashion, I think that's exciting. Distance shrinks in this medium. I think we're going to see it used throughout education in the United States, pre-college level, college, professional level. That's exciting across the planet. There's definitely been a trend towards remote learning. I think that's been unevenly distributed. This is going to give us a second set of tools. We've had one way of doing things, and now we're going to have an additional way of doing things. And I think that's what's exciting. It's just like you're a chef or something. All of a sudden, they've said, here's an entirely new set of ingredients you've never worked with. To really make this technology work and to do so on the widest possible basis, we need to have the physical infrastructure in place to do that. So I'm sure you've been reading stories about what's happening at the pre-college level, places where they'd like to do online education and they don't have internet, they don't have a device to do that. We frame that as a digital divide. I'm teaching a class right now where we're talking about Federal Communications Commission broadband policy. Broadband is so incredibly important. So had this happened 10 years ago, I think we wouldn't be doing anything like we are doing now. When we built this country, we made a decision to make the post office, which was the most direct instantiation of the federal government, we put it everywhere, even in rural towns where there was no way that made financial sense because we wanted everyone to be connected together in this new democratic enterprise that was the United States. Shrinking the digital divide is really about federal resources. The COVID crisis makes it clear how important this is. privacy issues are obviously important. Now, as we bring this into our educational environment, what am I allowed to screenshot? Can I take pictures of students? Are those educational records? We have a federal privacy statute for student records that controls all of that. If I want to use a camera to take a screenshot, it's not as visible as it is in a classroom. And so how we bring the right privacy values to this new environment is something we're going to work out. Law evolves in conjunction with social evolution. As technology evolves, along with it. I think we need to be careful with regard to technology. I think there will be a temptation to think we can swap in technology for the in-person experience that shows up in a classroom. And I think that would be wrong. I'm staring into a camera right now. So the idea that we could put this camera in the front of the classroom, we've delivered an education, a rigorous education, an education where you test and consider ideas, reject some, accept others. I think it would be a mistake to think we can simply swap one in and swap out the other. We need to augment, not replace. 5 years from now, we'll be beyond the medical crisis, beyond the economic crisis, and we'll be able to take this technology in this period of experimentation, and we will have figured out really how to put it to use. I think that means that we will be shrinking distances. We will be able to bring people into a classroom in an easy fashion. The country, the world runs on ideas. We need to get those ideas in as many possible ways to as many possible people. I think this technology is going to help us do that.
I hope all of you have watched this video. You see, one interesting observation the professor has made. That observation is that nothing can replace...
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for this THE In Conversation, looking at the impact of the coronavirus on global higher education. I'm...
Who is that?
Sridhar? Yeah. I'm just coming here now. So what I would say is that one interesting observation, even a professor from Chicago says that digital cannot change the classroom environment. So classroom environment is a must. Digital system can only be a supplement to classroom environment. So friends, so you are going to be there to really again get back to the classrooms and probably in future. So I wish you all the best in your teaching endeavor. And I thank the management, principal, and my friend Hari Prasad for giving me the opportunity to share my views and opinions to you. And thank you one and all.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, Bhavani, sir.
Tell me.
Sir, thank you very much for your sparing your valuable time with us.
Yeah, I'm going out. I'll be logging out just now.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Okay. All the faculty members, all the participants, please go to the chat box and fill the feedback form. In the chat box, there is a link is provided to you. Please go through the feedback form. All of you, please. 15 minutes is there up to 7:45. The Zoom meeting will be open. Please fill the feedback form. Sridhar sir, please post the feedback form link again.